Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Memoranda During the War from Specimen Days by Walt Whitman. Narrated by Robert Gorman. This performance is copyrighted 1988 by Recorded Books Incorporated. Large-boned and fleshy, easily 200 pounds, robust and eccentric, Walt Whitman had published his first edition of Leaves of Grass in 1855, at the age of 36, a homemade book that he paid for and helped print himself. Loud, garrulous, bizarrely sexual, it fell unheard on the ears of an American public that 4 years earlier had ignored Moby Dick, and the previous year had passed on Walden. There were a dozen poems, with titles like There Was a Child Went Forth, I Sing the Body Electric, and the longest, Song of Myself, and in them Whitman celebrated America. The United States themselves are essentially the greatest poem, he wrote. He was also celebrating himself. An individual is as superb as a nation. The soul of the largest and wealthiest and proudest nation may well go halfway to meet that of its poets. The proof of a poet is that his country absorbs him as affectionately as he has absorbed it. Whitman was experimenting with himself, as Thoreau had gone to Walden Pond a few years earlier for his experiment, trying to create the perfect man. He would compose a poem in which he, Walt Whitman, would speak as that man, a full-sized man, unconquerable and simple. And not only would he speak as that man, he would become him. He would change himself as America was changing the world. Years later, he called this experiment personalism, believing that democracy stands or falls with its ability to give rise to complete individuals. 6 years later, at the age of 42, and after two subsequent editions of Leaves of Grass that each time included more poems, war broke out between the states of his beloved America. His brother, George, joined the Union Army, and the following year, Walt Whitman opened a New York newspaper to find George's name among the wounded of Fredericksburg. He boarded a train that night, heading for Washington, D.C., where he hoped to find his brother in one of the hospitals there. George's wound proved to be nominal, and he was soon released back into service. And Whitman found himself lingering in Washington, absorbing the compelling scenes going on all around him. He soon embarked upon the most trying and exciting experience of his life. Whitman's existence revolved around visiting the hospitals of Washington for the next 4 or 5 years, even after the war had ended. He brought a kind word, a smile, a small gift to the young men brought by the boatload from the battlefields all around the Capitol, to the long whitewashed sheds temporarily thrown up all over town. He sat by the hour with the sick and dying, wrote letters home for them, nursed them back to health, or eased their tragic death. In Leaves of Grass, he had imagined himself a healing spirit, inviting America to the adventure of self-creation. But he had begun to doubt his ability to match in the flesh his larger-than-life voice. Now, as he roved the hospitals, he suddenly found himself face to face with the very Americans he had tried to speak to in his poetry. Young farmers and laborers, mechanics, bus drivers, average individuals. And he himself suddenly the incredible personality that could bring them health or release. Once he had dreamed of uniting the continent as America's driving voice. Now he put aside his metaphors and became instead just a man. He never spoke of his poems. He was living them. Whitman kept enormous volumes of notebooks all his life, in which he jotted events of the day, remarks on people he had met, views of the world. The pages he kept during the war are unlike any other record we have of those years. In 1875, he published selections from his diaries in a book called Memoranda During the War. Later, he absorbed the pieces into a larger volume of memoirs called Specimen Days, much as he continued to include all his later poems into further editions of Leaves of Grass. But his years in the hospitals had changed him and marked the beginning of his old age. His vitality was sapped by constant contact with death and tragedy. His health started to fail. The Civil War, capped by the devastating assassination of Lincoln, had broken him. He no longer had the strength to be the rowdy, verbal adventurer of his youth, and he settled down instead into the public's image of him as the good gray poet. A quiet man of wisdom, much changed from the vivid, vital American rough he celebrated in Song of Myself. In his later life, Whitman himself described the Civil War years as the centerpiece of his life. And now, Memoranda During the War from Specimen Days.
1862. I estimate three leading sources and formative stamps to my own character, now solidified for good or bad, and its subsequent literary and other outgrowth. The maternal nativity stock brought hither from faraway Netherlands for one, doubtless the best. The subterranean tenacity and central bony structure, obstinacy, willfulness, which I get from my paternal English elements for another. And the combination of my Long Island birth spot, seashores, childhood scenes, absorptions, with teeming Brooklyn and New York, with, I suppose, my experiences afterward in the secession outbreak for the third. For in 1862, startled by news that my brother George, an officer in the 51st New York Volunteers, had been seriously wounded at the first Fredericksburg battle, December 13th, I hurriedly went down to the field of war in Virginia. But I must go back a little. Opening of the Secession War. News of the attack on Fort Sumter and the flag at Charleston Harbor, South Carolina, was received in New York City late at night on April the 13th, 1861, and was immediately sent out in extras of the newspapers. I had been to the opera in 14th Street that night, and after the performance was walking down Broadway toward 12 o'clock on my way to Brooklyn, when I heard in the distance the loud cries of the newsboys, who came presently tearing and yelling up the street, rushing from side to side even more furiously than usual. I bought an extra and crossed to the Metropolitan Hotel, Niblo's, where the great lamps were still brightly blazing, and with a crowd of others who'd gathered impromptu, read the news, which was evidently authentic. For the benefit of some who had no papers, one of us read the telegram aloud, while all listened silently and attentively. No remark was made by any of the crowd, which had increased to 30 or 40, but all stood a minute or two, I remember, before they dispersed. I can almost see them there now, under the lamps at midnight again. National Uprising and Volunteering. I have said somewhere that the three presidentiads preceding 1861 showed how the weakness and wickedness of rulers are just as eligible here in America under Republican as in Europe under dynastic influences. But what can I say of that prompt and splendid wrestling with secession slavery? The archenemy personified, the instant he unmistakably showed his face. The volcanic upheaval of the nation, after that firing on the flag at Charleston, proved for certain something which had been previously in great doubt, and at once substantially settled the question of disunion. In my judgment, it will remain as the grandest and most encouraging spectacle yet vouchsafed in any age, old or new, to political progress and democracy. It was not for what came to the surface merely, though that was important, but what it indicated below, which was of eternal importance. Down in the abysms of New World humanity, there had formed and hardened a primal hardpan of national union will, determined and in the majority, refusing to be tampered with or argued against, confronting all emergencies and capable at any time of bursting all surface bonds and breaking out like an earthquake. It is, indeed, the best lesson of the century or of America, and it is a mighty privilege to have been part of it. Two great spectacles, immortal proofs of democracy, unequaled in all the history of the past, are furnished by the Secession War, one at the beginning, the other at its close. Those are the general, voluntary armed upheaval and the peaceful and harmonious disbanding of the armies in the summer of 1865. Contemptuous feeling. Even after the bombardment of Sumter, however, the gravity of the revolt and the power and will of the slave states for a strong and continued military resistance to national authority were not at all realized at the North, except by a few. 9/10 of the people of the free states looked upon the rebellion, as started in South Carolina, from a feeling 1/2 of contempt and the other half composed of anger and incredulity. It was not thought it would be joined in by Virginia, North Carolina, or Georgia. A great and cautious national official predicted that it would blow over in 60 days, and folks generally believed the prediction. I remember talking about it on a Fulton ferry boat with the Brooklyn mayor, who said he only hoped the Southern fire eaters would commit some overt act of resistance, as they would then be at once so effectually squelched we would never hear of secession again. But he was afraid they never would have the pluck to really do anything. I remember, too, that a couple of companies of the 13th Brooklyn, who rendezvoused at the city armory and started thence as 30 days men, were all provided with pieces of rope, conspicuously tied to their musket barrels, with which to bring back each man a prisoner from the audacious South, to be led in on a noose, and our men's early and triumphant return. Battle of Bull Run, July 1861. All this sort of feeling was destined to be arrested and reversed by a terrible shock, the Battle of First Bull Run, certainly, as we now know it, one of the most singular fights on record. All battles and their results are far more matters of accident than is generally thought. But this was throughout a casualty, a chance. Each side supposed it had won till the last moment. One had, in point of fact, just the same right to be routed as the other. By a fiction or series of fictions, the national forces at the last moment exploded in panic and fled from the field. The defeated troops commenced pouring into Washington over the Long Bridge at daylight on Monday the 22nd, day drizzling all through with rain. The Saturday and Sunday of the battle, the 20th and the 21st, had been parched and hot to an extreme. The dust, the grime and smoke in layers, sweated in, followed by other layers again sweated in, absorbed by those excited souls. Their clothes all saturated with the clay powder filling the air, stirred up everywhere on the dry roads and trodden fields by the regiments, swarming wagons and artillery. All the men with this coating of murk and sweat and rain, now recoiling back, pouring over the Long Bridge, a horrible march of 20 miles, returning to Washington, baffled, humiliated, panic-struck. Where are the vaunts and the proud boast with which you went forth? Where are your banners and your bands of music and your ropes to bring back your prisoners? Well, there isn't a band playing, and there isn't a flag but clings ashamed and lank to its staff. The sun rises, but shines not. The men appear, at first sparsely and shame-faced enough, then thicker in the streets of Washington, appear in Pennsylvania Avenue and on the steps and basement entrances. They come along in disorderly mobs, some in squads, stragglers, companies. Occasionally, a rare regiment in perfect order, with its officers, some gaps, dead, the true braves, marching in silence with lowering faces, stern, weary to sinking, all black and dirty, but every man with his musket and stepping alive. But these are the exceptions. Sidewalks of Pennsylvania Avenue, 14th Street, crowded, jammed with citizens, darkies, clerks, everybody, lookers-on, women in the windows, curious expressions from faces, as though swarms of dirt-covered returned soldiers there. Will they never end? Move by. But nothing said. No comments. Half our lookers-on, secesh of the most venomous kind. They say nothing. But the devil snickers in their faces. During the forenoon, Washington gets all over motley with these defeated soldiers. Queer-looking objects, strange eyes and faces, drenched. The steady rain drizzles on all day, and fearfully worn, hungry, haggard, blistered in the feet. Good people, but not over many of them either, hurry up something for their grub. They put wash kettles on the fire, for soup, for coffee. They set tables on the sidewalks. Wagon loads of bread are purchased, swiftly cut in stout chunks. Here are two aged ladies, beautiful, the first in the city for culture and charm. They stand with store of eating and drink at a table of rough plank, and give food and half the store replenished from their house every half hour all that day. And there in the rain they stand, active, silent, white-haired, and give food, though the tears stream down their cheeks, almost without intermission the whole time. Amid the deep excitement, crowds in motion, and desperate eagerness, it seems strange to see many, very many, of the soldiers sleeping, in the midst of all, sleeping sound. They drop down anywhere, on the steps of houses, up close by the basements or fences, on the sidewalk, aside on some vacant lot, and deeply sleep. A poor 17 or 18-year-old boy lies there, on the stoop of a grand house. He sleeps so calmly, so profoundly. Some clutch their muskets firmly, even in sleep, some in squads, comrades, brothers, close together, and on them, as they lay, sulkily drips the rain. As afternoon passed and evening came, the streets, the barrooms, knots everywhere, listeners, questioners, terrible yarns, bugaboo, masked batteries, our regiment all cut up. Stories and storytellers, windy, bragging, vain centers of street crowds. Resolution, manliness seem to have abandoned Washington. The principal hotel, Willard's, is full of shoulder straps, thick, crushed, creeping with shoulder straps. I see them, and must have a word with them. There you are, shoulder straps. But where are your companies? Where are your men? Incompetence. Never tell me of chances of battle, of getting strayed, and the like. I think this is your work, this retreat after all. Sneak, blow, put on airs there in Willard's sumptuous parlors and bar rooms, or anywhere. No explanation shall save you. Bull Run is your work. Had you been half or one-tenth worthy your men, this would never have happened. Meantime, in Washington, among the great persons and their entourage, a mixture of awful consternation, uncertainty, rage, shame, helplessness, and stupefying disappointment. The worst is not only imminent, but already here. In a few hours, perhaps before the next meal, the Secesh generals, with their victorious hordes, will be upon us. The dream of humanity, the vaunted Union we thought so strong, so impregnable, lo! It seems already smashed like a china plate. One bitter, bitter hour. Perhaps proud America will never again know such an hour. She must pack and fly. No time to spare. Those white palaces, the dome-crowned capital there on the hill, so stately over the trees, shall be left, or destroyed first? For it is certain that the talk among certain of the magnates and officers and clerks and officials everywhere for 24 hours in and around Washington after Bull Run was loud and undisguised for yielding out and out, and substituting the Southern rule, and Lincoln promptly abdicating and departing. If the Secesh officers and forces had immediately followed, and by a bold Napoleonic movement had entered Washington the first day, or even the second, they could have had the things their own way, and a powerful faction north to back them. One of our returning colonels expressed in public that night, amid a swarm of officers and gentlemen in a crowded room, the opinion that it was useless to fight, that the Southerners had made their title clear, and that the best course for the national government to pursue was to desist from any further attempt at stopping them, and admit them again to the lead, on the best terms they were willing to grant. Not a voice was raised against this judgment, amid that large crowd of officers and gentlemen. The fact is, the hour was one of the three or four of those crises we had then and afterward, during the fluctuations of 4 years, when human eyes appeared, at least just as likely to see the last breath of the Union as to see it continue. The stupor passes, something else begins. But the hour, the day, the night passed, and whatever returns, an hour, a day, a night like that can never again return. The President, recovering himself, begins that very night, sternly, rapidly sets about the task of reorganizing his forces, and placing himself in positions for future and surer work. If there was nothing else of Abraham Lincoln for history to stamp him with, it is enough to send him with his wreath to the memory of all future time, that he endured that hour, that day, bitterer than gall, indeed a crucifixion day, that it did not conquer him, that he unflinchingly stemmed it, and resolved to lift himself and the Union out of it. Then the great New York papers at once appeared, commencing that evening and following it up the next morning, and incessantly through many days afterwards, with leaders that rang out over the land with the loudest, most reverberating ring of clearest bugles, full of encouragement, hope, inspiration, and unfaltering defiance. Those magnificent editorials, they never flagged for a fortnight. The Herald commenced them. I remember the articles well. The Tribune was equally cogent and inspiriting, and the Times, Evening Post, and other principal papers were not a whit behind. They came in good time, for they were needed. For in the humiliation of Bull Run, the popular feeling North, from its extreme of superciliousness, recoiled to the depth of gloom and apprehension. Of all the days of the war, there are two especially I can never forget. Those were the day following the news in New York and Brooklyn of that first Bull Run defeat, and the day of Abraham Lincoln's death. I was home in Brooklyn on both occasions. The day of the murder, we heard the news very early in the morning. Mother prepared breakfast, and other meals afterwards, as usual. But not a mouthful was eaten all day by either of us. We each drank half a cup of coffee, that was all. Little was said. We got every newspaper morning and evening, and the frequent extras of that period, and passed them silently to each other. Down at the front. Falmouth, Virginia, opposite Fredericksburg, December the 21st, 1862. Begin my visits among the camp hospitals in the Army of the Potomac. Spend a good part of the day in a large brick mansion on the banks of the Rappahannock, used as a hospital since the battle. Seems to have received only the worst cases. Outdoors, at the foot of a tree, within 10 yards of the front of the house, I notice a heap of amputated feet, legs, arms, and hands, a full load for a one-horse cart. Several dead bodies lie near, each covered with its brown woolen blanket. In the dooryard, towards the river, are fresh graves, mostly of officers, their names on pieces of barrel staves or broken boards stuck in the dirt. Most of these bodies were subsequently taken up and transported north to their friends. The large mansion is quite crowded upstairs and down. Everything impromptu, no system, all bad enough, but I have no doubt the best that can be done. All the wounds pretty bad, some frightful. The men in their old clothes, unclean and bloody. Some of the wounded are rebel soldiers and officers, prisoners. One, a Mississippian, a captain, hit badly in leg. I talked with him some time. He asked me for papers, which I gave him. I saw him 3 months afterwards in Washington, with his leg amputated, doing well. I went through the rooms, downstairs and up. Some of the men were dying. I had nothing to give at that visit, but wrote a few letters to folks home, to mothers, etc. Also talked to three or four, who seemed most susceptible to it and needing it. After first Fredericksburg.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.